Part 6, Roxy's Plan. The hooligans wouldn't eat anything. However, and as morning wore on, all anyone could think about was water. Roxy was desperately thirsty too. "We won't last very long if we don't get water soon," said Helvetia. "Anyone got an idea?" She was looking, of course, at Roxy. "If those men are hiding out here," Roxy told the hooligans, "they must have brought some water with them as well as food. And they probably came in a boat. If we can find it, maybe we can get home again." "Never mind the boat," said Simon Sarley, his dry lips sticking together as he talked. "I just want a drink." "Well, since we don't have any water of our own, we'll just have to borrow some of theirs," said Roxy. "And who's going to do that?" said Helvetia. "Someone tall and skinny who can hide behind trees," said Roxy. "Someone like Simon."
"Oh no, not me," said Simon Sarley.
"Why not?" asked Helvetia. Simon Sarley thought for a moment. "I'm allergic to bark," he said.
"What?"
said Helvetia. "One of you is afraid of the dark, and one is allergic to bark? What kind of hooligans are you anyway?" This time, Smokey Joe was the only one who laughed. "Then I guess I'll go myself," said Roxy. And with the hooligans staring after her, off she went. She could never capture a rogue elephant, she knew, and she might never survive an avalanche, but she could do this. Her clothes were still damp from the day before. Her shirt clung to her body. Her brown and green skirt had lost its pleats. The sweater was filthy from sand and seaweed, and her knee socks had 3 holes in one and 4 in the other. Her shoes seemed to have shrunk on her feet. It was dark in the woods. It was scary. Roxy moved as if she were stalking deer. 10 slow steps forward and stop. Wait. 10 slow steps and stop. Wait. Just as Lord Thistlebottom had instructed in his book. She did not know if the men were camped here in the woods at the south end of the island or camped in the trees at the north end. 10 steps more. Wait. 10 steps more. Wait. Finally, she reached the seagrass, and peeping out from behind a tree, Roxy saw the 2 robbers heading off to the east side of the island with some fishing line. When she was quite sure they were out on the rocks, she crept through the seagrass until she finally saw their tent in the trees beyond. Her heart pounded so hard. She was almost afraid the men could hear it. Step by step, step by step, she pushed her way through the brush until she came to the tent. She stopped. She listened. Then she stepped just inside, afraid to go any further. There were 2 sleeping bags, a pile of clothes, a couple of pans, sacks, and boxes. Somewhere in those boxes, there must be water. But once inside the tent, there was only one way out. What if the men came back? Roxy went back out again and moved through the tall seagrass until she could see both men over on the rocks. Then, breathing hard, she slipped back inside the tent and over to the stuff piled in one corner. She looked through the sacks and stopped to listen for footsteps. A swish, swish sound came from outside. Frantically, she dived for the tent opening. But the men were still on the rocks, and what she had heard was only the wind blowing the seagrass. Roxy went back a third time. This time, when she lifted a sock, she saw that the box beneath was filled with plastic bottles of water. Quickly, Roxy took 5 of the bottles. She stuck one down the waistband of her skirt, tucked one under her left arm, one under her right, and with a bottle in each hand, she crept back out of the tent and started off through the seagrass. Looking toward the sea, however, she saw only one man on the rocks. Her heart leaped and she stood frozen where she was. But then the second man's head appeared a little farther on, and their backs were bent over their fishing gear. Roxy moved on, her footsteps in time with her beating heart. When she was quite sure she could not be seen, she stopped and took the cap off one of the bottles. Slowly, slowly, she drank four long gulps. Then she walked on to where the hooligans were waiting for her. When they saw her coming, they licked their parched lips and grabbed for the bottles. But Roxy held up one hand. "Only four swallows, eight," she warned them.
"Yeah, who says?" said Simon, grabbing one for himself.
"I says," said Hovisha, whacking him on the head. "Four swallows, eight, just like she said. When it's gone, it's gone." One by one, each hooligan took a turn with the bottle, the rest watching and counting the number of swallows.
"Five! You took five, Simon!" Smoky Joe said accusingly.
"So what?" said Simon. He handed the bottle back. "However, I'm hungry, I'm tired, and my clothes are still wet."
"Mine too," said Freddy Fields. "I hate this place."
"How long are we going to be here anyway?" squeaked Smoky Joe in her not quite so mean little mouse voice.
"Someone should be looking for us by now," said Roxy. "The teacher will have missed us in class yesterday, and our parents know we didn't come home from school."
"My parents won't miss me," said Helvetia, putting the cap back on the bottle. "I'll bet they said, 'Good riddance.'"
"Yeah,"
said Freddy. "I wouldn't be surprised if my dad didn't even know I was gone."
"Mine either," said Smoky Joe.
Roxy sat down at the end of a log. Her clothes were wet too, and she was hungry, just like the rest of them. But she knew for sure that her parents missed her. She knew for sure that someone wanted her back. And that meant she had something the hooligans didn't the best reason to go home.